Good evening, my name is Robert and I try things. On Thursdays, I try whatever game or games are free from the Epic Game Store. Problem is, I've technically already tried The Sims, and I don't know anything about how to get into these expansion packs that were free this week. I redeemed them, I have them. No idea that, like, would I have to start a new game? Does it start with those? Do I get to, like, pick new areas, or is it like later game stuff that I'd have to have played for dozens of hours already to get to it? I don't know. So I'm just going to leave it alone. And instead, we are going to spin the wheel. And RNGesus will be deciding what I try this evening. But it's been a week, an entire week, since I streamed because I was unmotivated on Sunday to stream because I had no physical activity. That was the main reason that I didn't want to stream on Sunday. because I did nothing physically all day. I sat and I played video games. And that's kind of what I did today. So I realized that I hadn't done anything physical, so I went out back and I did some air squats. So now I'm feeling a lot better. I can stream. I'm going to enjoy myself. I'm glad Taylor is here. Taylor will be here in 16 days. And in 7 days will be my in-laws, who I actually like. I like spending time with them. I'm looking forward to hanging out with both of them, honestly. My father-in-law is cool. My mother-in-law is cool. They're great. I really appreciate them. I like my in-laws a lot more than Paige likes her in-laws. My family can be a little nuts. Hers is nuts. Mine's a little more nuts and in a little more toxic way. Every family is some degree of toxic because nobody's perfect, but yeah. You even get to leave your car at your buddy's house. Sweet. Your family's toxic. My family is passive-aggressively toxic and doesn't deal with their issues with themselves or with each other. And so they just bottle things up until they all explode on Easter Sunday when everybody's together and somebody overcooked the hot dogs. I don't know that that's exactly what happened, but there have been explosions on Easters multiple times when I was younger. Yeah, so I'm kind of amazed that some of my family is still talking to some of my family. So yeah, Paige's family is not like that. They are quite matriarchal and traditional, which has its own issues, but it's not... I don't know. I'm not as inside with her family as I am with mine, so I won't be able to analyze that as well. So, we have two gigantic maple trees in our backyard, and I think it's another maple tree that's up front. I would have to go and confirm that, but I know these two in the back are maples. Pretty sure that one's a maple. So there are little helicopter seeds all over the yard. They have all fallen out of the trees by now, or 90%+ of them have fallen out of the trees. And the ones that have landed in fertile places have begun to sprout. And you know what the most fertile place on my property is? My garden. I have pulled something like 10 little maple tree sproutlings out of my garden. They're really neat, but I do not need a maple tree growing in my garden and, yeah, taking up all that space and stealing all the nutrients from my carrots, mostly carrots, and tomatoes and cucumbers. Maple trees are nice, but I've already got three. I'm good. Neighbor's got some. He has an oak tree. I don't know what kind of tree that one is, or theirs. Theirs looks like it has ferns. As leaves, it could be some kind of willow. I don't know. And I pointed that direction twice. I have two neighbors on the backside. Their names are both Mike. I have Mike and Mike. And I actually need to go and talk to them in the next few days because I'm going to rent a pole saw and climb up and cut about half a dozen dead branches out of this Mike's tree. And one particular dead branch out of this Mike's tree that are hanging over the fence. It's not my fence. I don't give a shit about the fence. I'm not going to damage the fence. I'm going to do my damnedest not to damage the fence. But it's not my fence. I don't care. I don't like the branches. And this one in particular, the half dozen or so, are dropping sticks all over my yard that, you know, every day I go out, there's an entire bundle of sticks I need to pick up. So I just want to get them all down all at once. And then there's also a dead branch in one of my maples that needs to come down, and another branch that's growing like toward the corner of the deck back here that is like whapping you in the face if you go the wrong direction coming down the stairs off the deck. So I want to cut that one off just for convenience sake. And I believe that's it. But yeah, so I don't have to tell them that I'm cutting these branches that are over the fence hanging over my yard. But I want to be courteous and say, hey, Mike, I wanted to let you know there's a couple of dead branches in your tree hanging over my fence and I'm going to cut them down just to get them out of the way. And there's nothing they can say about it. Say, no, you can't do that. Yes, I can. I just wanted to let you know. I don't think they'll say that. Yeah, it is just a courtesy, literally just a courtesy. And I don't think either, I've actually not interacted with this mic at all. And I only interacted with this mic when they were replacing their part of the fence back here. Ooh, woo, hey, we got. Oh, that's a sound alert. Okay, I was like, why do I have sound alerts? Because I enabled the browser source. Okay. Anyway, I've only interacted with this mic very briefly when they were fixing, replacing their fence, and seemed like a chill guy. Should be fine. Hello, Ewio, and probably Kowa and Klawa, although you might be back home by now, getting ready to move. Hi. Gosh, I need to not be uwu with anybody but you, honestly. Cora and Clara can have normal Robert. So anyway, say all of that business about the trees. We have two maple trees, and they're falling in my garden. And I've... No, Taylor, sorry. You're not going to get uwu. It's just Ariel. Ariel is the uwu, the goddess Gothuwu, queen mommy Ariel. So these little maple leaves, they're the helicopter leaves. Let's see if I can get it to helicopter past the camera. Nope, not high enough. Hold on. You sort of saw it. I saw it go past. It's not... It's really fast. There it goes. But it is a helicopter leaf. It's great. But about 10 of them-ish have sprouted in my garden. Hi, Charlie! Exclamation mark kitty in chat to count how many times the cats have shown up on the stream. This is Charlie. He's our youngest. He's about 2. He probably saw me throwing the seed, and he's looking up like, where did the seed come from? Where did it go? Where did you come from, Maple Tree Joe? Ariel's still on a call with Cora, so be in and out. Okay, cool. Charlie, you're redonk, dude. Love you. Anyway, I plucked like 10 of these out of the garden. Let's see. Let me see if I can adjust the focus here. Got my focus slider. That's as good as I can get it. I don't know. You can mostly tell what that is. So it's one of these helicopter seeds that has sprouted, and there's a whole ass tree trying to grow out of it. Officially move in with her on Sunday. Sweet. But yeah, those are maple leaves, and that's a maple root. Maybe if I move the focus the other direction, maybe I was going... Yeah, hold on. There it is. Okay, so now we are in focus. So you get the whole little maple seedling experience. So eventually the helicopter part just falls off and falls away. You've got these two bigger leaves that were the germ inside the seed, and the root comes out of the end of that. Move sooner. Move out. Okay, move out of your grandma's guest house sooner. Sweet. I'm so proud of Taylor and how he's come with his job situation and after what had happened with it previously. Okay, so higher number means focus is closer to the camera, and lower number means focus is farther away from the camera. I never realized that. Plus, you got about $700 added to your paycheck on the way up because of PTO unused, because you took 0 days off in the year? Not quite a year that you worked for Scouts? Is it just me or is the music really quiet? 6 months-ish? Oh, okay. I thought it was longer. The last 6 months, winter has felt like years. Hate winter. Can't stand winter. I can't stand feeling trapped in my house because of cold and sunlight. Lack of sunlight. But it was a high of 95 on Saturday or Sunday, one of those. Taylor, why are we friends? How are we friends? You can't like the cold and be my friend. I recently decided that, nope. That argument, everybody uses that argument. No. You can only put on so many layers, and even then, are you enjoying it when you are bundled up with a foot thick of fabric around you. No. Everybody uses that argument, and no. You might be uncomfortable, but unless you're literally in the desert in 100 plus degrees with no shade and no water, you're not gonna die. Yeah, sweater and two jackets in negative 13 weather in St. Louis and you're happy. Okay. I guess some people can enjoy it, which is why I decided that I am gonna stop simping for Splatzap. She talked about how she loves the cold and the dark, and I'm just like, Splatzap, I love you, but now I know that I cannot love you anything more than splatonically. Which, I used to have a button for this. Now I have to type it manually because I'm not using Touch Portal until I figure out what the fuck is going on with my stream and freezing and whatnot. I'm looking at log report here. The stream elements JavaScript is having problems, but that's normal for JavaScript. JavaScript loading is the bane of JavaScript developers, front-end JavaScript developers' existence. Cores, C-O-R-S, I know the S is security, but I can't remember. I can't remember what the rest of it is. But yeah, people who code JavaScript hate it. But it, forever, it's been the only option. And it's getting retired. I don't know what's replacing it. Yeah, Taylor. You know what we'll do? I was gonna say you need to go to the beach and just be at the beach and enjoy everything about the beach. The view, the heat, the water, the food. Go to Pensacola. Don't go to Gulf Shores. Don't go to Biloxi. Go to Pensacola. Exactly what you're doing next weekend. Yes, the beach. The beach is the best place in the world. Yes, I was about to say maybe not quite next to like Havasu or whatever, but no, beaches are better. Beaches are the best, especially equatorial beaches. God, I just love beaches. Anyway, so yeah, showed you the little maple sproutling. Like, this is the cutest thing. I have tons and tons of carrot sprouts and something like 30 what are they called, sugar snap pea sprouts, and I've transplanted tomatoes and a cucumber, and I've got potatoes growing. I talked about how I was turning the soil in the garden and I found a couple of, what the hell are you? There are bugs from the sproutling. That's the only place I can think of that they'd be from. They're not tapeworms, as far as I can tell. I've seen tapeworms. Tapeworms are gross. They're these little slug larvae looking things that presumably came out of the sproutling. Okay. It's Mother's Day this weekend. Gonna celebrate your first week of new work by going to Pensacola. Yes. Have a couple margaritas on the beach. Grab some good seafood somewhere. Enjoy some music there and back. Yes. I don't know where there is a Buc-ee's on the way to Pensacola. I never remember seeing one. And I made that trip a lot before I moved in with Paige. I hope these aren't tapeworms. I'm pretty sure they're not. One around Foley? If there is, I always missed it. By the way, if they were tapeworms, they would have come out of the cat's butt. I'm really hoping they're not. We had tapeworms when James and Lily were kittens. Kind of surprised Charlie didn't have worms. But I can't remember if the vet dewormed him or not. Holy, let's see. Hold on. Let's Google that. Hold on. Buc-ee's, Alabama. Sure. Okay, so there's one down here. It is in Robertsdale. That is on the way to Pensacola. That's on 10. Although, well, it's not really from Hattiesburg, though. Because, hold on, let me remember where Hattiesburg is. Hold on. Well, okay, no, you go through, well, you go around Mobile. And then you've got 10. Yeah, it's all of this craziness that I never liked going to Pensacola. You've got 10. Going to Pensacola. Okay, there's Pensacola Beach. Wait. Huh. I never saw this. Huh. Hattiesburg to Mobile is 98. Up onto I-10 down to Pensacola. Okay. Okay, so there's 98. Somewhere... Semmes! I hate Semmes, Alabama. I hate Semmes, Alabama. Wilmer and Semmes, honestly, because 98 goes down to two lanes, and it's a 55, what's it called? Speed limit, and there are always so many semis, and it's like this because it's Alabama, and yeah, Semmes and Wilmer, hate them both. Mostly Semmes, but it starts in Wilmer, really. Well, okay, no, it kind of starts when you cross this lake, and well, it kind of starts coming out of, anyway. Hate it. Yes. Terrible. God awful. And there's no consistency in the speed, is the thing. And there are these couple of random stoplights where there's like maybe a logging site or a quarry or some kind of like concrete mixed place where trucks are entering the highway, so there has to be a light there. But other than that, the only other thing there is a goddamn BP, I think. It might not even be a branded gas station. It's just a gas station. And yes, I hate driving 98 through Semmes. Oh my gosh. It's a 2.5 hour trip. You know the main light there. It's got a gas station. Is there a quarry thing? I've never really paid attention. I've only ever really looked at the gas station. Yeah, no, it's stupid. Other than that, there's no reason for that light to be there. Anyway. And then Semmes itself is a speed trap town, like Semmes proper, down where there are multiple lights and the businesses and everything. Hey, Charlie, I wish I could show them the kitty cam, but I am testing whether or not the kitty cam is the source of the problem. Looks like one. Looks like a quarry. I don't know. I checked the log here, nothing showing up in the log. I'm gonna be paranoid about the stream, Charlie. You're so cute, man. He does the whole, like, head tilt thing when I look at him and talk to him. He's so cute. Yeah. No, 98 through Semmes is terrible. And then you get on 10, and it's not even very far. Was it 34? It's like a 2.5 hour trip, and I feel like it adds 20 minutes to it by having to go through Semmes. However, somewhere around there is Fusackli's chicken tenders. Let's look that up. Because Fusackli's to me is a close second to Cane's. Cane's is still king, but Fusackli's is a guy, I don't know about better. Now I will say I've only had it once and it was, I remember it being close, maybe comparable, but I don't know that I would call it better. Cane's doesn't season their chicken like Fusackli's does. I have not spun the wheel yet, Axie. I haven't decided what I'm playing yet. Is this it? Is that the one? It's in front of a Walmart. And it's like right across the river. Let me just go to the map. Yeah, okay, there's the Murphys. There's the Fusackli's. Presumably 98 is right out there. Over here is Walmart. Okay, so this is it. Okay. Their slaw is great. I don't remember getting their slaw or what it tasted like if I did get it. I just know that Cane's is king, but Fusakli's is really similar. You can get a salad at Fusakli's? What the hell? That's stupid. As far as seasoning the chicken, I can see how that would put it over the top for some people. The sauce looks really similar. I can see how seasoning the chicken would put it over the top for some people, but for me, the chicken is primarily a vehicle for getting the sauce into my mouth. There's this. Yeah, this is the slaw. I don't love slaw with pepper in it. But yeah, that looks almost exactly like Cane's. It's very knockoff Cane's. And I don't know which one came first. Vehicles in my mouth. So I read a tweet or something years ago that said, chicken tenders? You mean ranch shovels? And yeah, Cane's chicken tenders are Cane's sauce shovels to me. Vroom vroom, that's right, biatch. So the closest Cane's to me is in Lawrence. It's about a 40-minute drive to get to this Cane's because it's like in the middle of Lawrence. Got to get off the highway, whichever direction you come from, and go like a couple of miles into Lawrence. And I haven't been in a good while. So Taylor, good chance when you get here that we'll probably get Cane's while we're in Kansas City or on the way back or sometime while you're here. I'd like to have Cane's. You're an excuse to have Cane's. I am so jazzed that you're gonna be here. We're gonna have company for like two long weekends. Except there's a break in the middle. Okay, so Taylor will be here the 20. Okay, Paige's parents are getting here the 18th, and then they're leaving on the 21st. So then Taylor will be here the 26th or 7th through the 31st, right? Pretty sure. So yeah, Taylor will be here for at least this Sunday stream. Okay. While the in-laws are here, so mom is going to, they're coming a day early. They were originally intending to come on Friday, but they're coming a day early so that mom can work at Paige's desk. On the 18th, and then they'll be here for those days. What was I trying to say? And they've got a break for a few days, and then Taylor will be here. And Clay was thinking that he might come during these days between, but we told him, it might be good to have a break rather than having company for 2.5 solid weeks. Well, almost 2 solid weeks. So yeah. But it's gonna be fun. It's gonna be great. Taylor will be on stream in person on, when's he getting here again? The 28th. In person. Excuse me. So, okay, are we gonna spin the wheel to figure out what we're trying? I accidentally closed where I had picker wheel open. I took some things off the list and resized some things. End stream is now even tinier in relation to everything else. And then Borderlands 1 is smaller than the rest of these because I've been playing Borderlands 1. The rest of these I have not tried at all. So we'll spin the wheel and we'll figure out what we're going to get. But do we want to do a snack or drink first? How do we want to handle that? Okay, heads, yes, snack or drink. Tails, no. Hey, Google, flip a coin. Tails, so no snack or drink before we spin the wheel. Okay, let's figure out what we're going to be playing this evening. Fallout Tactics. That's Steam, right? Or was that Epic? Was it Epic? I think it might have been Epic. Forspoken is on sale for 33% off already? When was it released? It was released, that's not telling me, in January. So I guess maybe it's not doing super well. Or they've reached the end of their release peak and they're trying to get the people like me who are waiting for moments like this. Hey, it's right, hydrate time, to try these. However, something like this, I would want to invest a good amount of time in. And for that, I want it to be on a console. I want it to be on the PlayStation. So, yeah, I'm not getting this. Sorry. Okay, let's try Fallout Tactics. Get that installed. Oh, The Sims installed? Oh, I had installed it previously because the packs were coming up. We might go try it. Maybe later. I don't know. Maxie, how has your week been? Did you guys miss me on Sunday? I know Taylor and Erilyn did. They both messaged me like, are you not streaming? And I felt really bad to be letting them down. So yeah. This is not a very large game. It's installing pretty quickly. To be fair, we do have like 150 megabits a second fiber, but Against All Odds was stupid fun. And that's, I mean that literally. It was fun in a very stupid way. And it was stupid amounts of fun for what it is. Let's go to the store page and confirm that it is still a free game. It is still a free game. Okay. Let's try Fallout Tactics. It's the Brotherhood of Steel edition. There we go. You always forget everyone's schedule. Stream go boom? Stream no go boom. As far as I can tell. It just hiccuped. Okay. It's probably because Fallout is opened on this other screen. Hold on. There it is. Hey, that actually worked that time. The first Fallout games were terrible control and graphic wise, and I'm really surprised that they survived as long as they did. Direct play. Are you guys here? I can't see anything on my other screens. They have gone black. This needs to go quickly. Okay, okay. We're back. We lost 25 frames. In infamy. Oh. Damn it. Come on now. Why are we doing this like this? I really need you to. Okay. All I did was mute Spotify. Let's go to options and let's change our resolution. Do I get 1920 by 1080? Oh, there it is. It's near the top. Oh, that's better. Oh, that looks much nicer. It's smaller on the screen. Give that a shot. I can't see my preview. Hold on. I need to be able to see whether the stream has crashed. All right, intro, single player, multiplayer. Intro is playing the intro animation again. Of course, there's a whole tutorial section rather than... We're just doing a new game and... Let's take this guy.
Ten, hut. All right, you mutated redneck.
Is this supposed to be so small? Flesh.
Listen up. I am Paladin Rychek. I am in charge of training you backward maggots in the art of war and survival. In my time in the Brotherhood, I have personally trained more than 50 initiates, and I am proud to say almost 14 of them are still alive and kicking.
Almost 14.
I've ordered me to mold you flabby, hip-slapping, berry-picking, rat-rubbing Brahmin kissers into capable warriors.
None of them look flabby.
It, even if it kills you. I will teach you how to eat, sleep, walk, talk, shoot, spit like a Brotherhood soldier.
First level of training will be recruitment detail. You'll go to the surrounding villages and see what able-bodied primates are ready for an honest life's work. It is your duty to remind the village elders that if they want continued protection from the scum of this world, they will uphold their end of the bargain by providing resources and their best and brightest for Brotherhood training. Now get your weak-kneed, superstitious, soft-skinned, uneducated butts to the armory. You will be issued basic weapons and armor. There are three simple rules to follow with Brotherhood equipment. If you damage your weapon, you will spend a week in the box. If you damage your armor, you will spend a week in the box. If you lose either, I'll kill you myself. And one final thing, ladies. Welcome to the Brotherhood of Steel.
This guy looks like the Fallout version of Buzz Lightyear.
My name is General Barnicky. I will be giving you your orders.
Now we have the full resolution.
But before that, I'd like to personally welcome you aboard. Considering that the Brotherhood basic training attrition rate is 85%, you should be very proud of yourself. Now, on to business. Two nights ago, raiders invaded the resource-rich tribal village of Brahminwood. Their losses have been heavy, and they are now ready to accept the Brotherhood's conditions for protection. We will return their lands and rescue these primitive people in exchange for food and a portion of their older children for new recruits. We must expand our ranks to meet our objectives, which makes every village count. I don't know what is driving the raiders this close to our base of operations, but they have been punishing the surrounding area. Brahminwood is one of many villages that is now occupied by raiders. The inhabitants that did not escape have been slain or imprisoned. Make no mistake, initiate, they have killed a fair amount of our brothers. Do not underestimate them. You will take your squad to Brahminwood, locate and eliminate the leader of the group of raiders. Once he is removed, his followers will surely fall into disarray. You will then use the Brotherhood's superior might and intellect to butcher the remaining criminals. This is a standard assault mission, so consult the map in your Pip-Boy for the latest intelligence on the area. One more thing, warrior. You must ensure that the village elder survives. He is the key to our plans for this town. According to the local tribal custom, he alone deals with outsiders. Without him, we can have no agreement with the rest of the tribe.
Dismiss. Okay. Start mission. We are gonna... How do I move the camera? What does S... Oh, S is save. Okay. Quick keys. Alt S, quit save. Da, da, da. Cursor keys, scroll the map. Escape, main menu toggle. Or S, skill dex toggle. What are the cursor keys? I don't know. Okay. So there are three of us, and then there's these two villagers, and he's fine. She's fine. All right, all three of you, go across the bridge. Okay, there's the raiders, there's a dog. Suppose we should probably attack the dog first. Oh shit, there's a guy. What doesn't look like much of a challenge? Oh, are you shooting me? Shit. Shit, shit, shit. Maybe I should have done the tutorials. I'm flying by the seat of my pants. Single click to attack. Okay, so I see health bars down here. Why aren't you two attacking? Maybe I should have done the tutorials. Do not switch off. Nick is gonna die. Why? What? Why won't you go over and attack him? And you, why aren't you attacking? God damn it. Exit to the main, and we're gonna do a tutorial.
Recruit!
Basic.
Attention! I am Paladin Ziskel. The elders have ordered me to mold you lizard-chasing, hut-dwelling, moon-worshipping savages into Brotherhood of Steel initiates. You are going to learn the basics of combat, followed by inventory management and other skills. First, let's talk about this miracle of technology which you are currently using, called the Pip-Boy 2000 computer. You will receive all your mission briefs and debriefs through this device, and you can use it to review any information you receive during a mission. Pay careful attention, as you will be given a lot of very useful information. Now begin the mission by left-clicking on Start Mission. Let's get started, recruit. During the mission, you can view your surroundings by using the cursor keys to scroll the viewing window. You can also use your mouse to scroll the window by holding it over the border of the desired direction. Center the game window on Rex by right-clicking on his control tab. Take a look around. You will only be able to see the enemy if there is a direct line of sight between them and at least one of your squad members. Rex is carrying a submachine gun, SMG, in his left hand. This is his currently selected weapon. If you don't have a weapon in your selected hand, then you can perform hand-to-hand attacks. It might not sound like much, but nothing ever feels as good as delivering a mailed fist to some unsuspecting raider's snot box.
Snot box.
We're going to target the dummy nearest to Rex by moving the cursor over it. When we do this, the pointer changes to a targeting cursor. Now, click Done. Target the dummy. To make Rex move, you must left-click on the location you want him to move to. If you hold the shift key down when you left-click, Rex will run to that location. Now move Rex to the training station 2 by left-clicking on the area of floor marked 02. Most weapons have more than one mode. For example, the SMG can be used in either single-shot or burst mode. Click Done, and right-click on the SMG to change it to single-shot mode and shoot the next dummy.
Single shot only costs 4 AP, burst costs 5 AP. Okay.
Every character in the game has an inventory associated with them. Close this window and look at Rex's inventory by left-clicking on the button marked INV in the panel in the bottom right of the screen. The inventory window will list all the items that a character is currently carrying. You can get additional information on any item in the inventory by left-clicking on it. Rex currently has ammunition for the SMG and is also carrying a knife. When you have a squad of characters, you can redistribute items amongst them by opening a character's inventory and dragging items to the other characters or their character tabs. But this only works if the characters involved are close to one another. Close this window and drag the knife down to Rex's right hand to get him ready for a melee attack. After you have equipped Rex with the knife, close the inventory.
Okay, so I guess this is his right hand. Okay. Aaron Knight says, if Axie is still here, can you tell him to shut the fuck up? Why?
Melee attacks are initialized in exactly what the same way as ranged attacks. Select the knife as your chosen weapon by left-clicking on it in the hand slot. Right-click on the dummy at Training Station 3, and Rex will walk up to it and attack it with a knife.
Okay. Right-click.
You can loot corpses That's good. To see that if they works. Contain any items of interest. Do not think of this as dishonorable. Your dead enemies have a wealth of items to aid the Brotherhood. Weapons, armor, ammo, money. It's all out there for the taking. Close this window and loot the body of the dummy you have just attacked by left-clicking on it.
Loot the dummy. He has a
This key. Window shows two inventories. On the left side of the screen is Rex's inventory. On the right side of the screen is the inventory of the dummy, which we are going to loot from. Take the key from the dummy by left-clicking on it, holding and dragging it into Rex's inventory.
Sound alerts are working currently. Okay.
The key you have found is one of many unbelievably useful objects littered around the wastelands. You must use it to unlock the door to the next room. Left-click on the door, and Rex will walk up to it and unlock it. Now, left-click on the door to open it, and walk through...
Okay... Ah, there we go. It's unlocked. Now we open it. Continue through to station
Many
four.
Items in the world are in containers, hidden from prying eyes and sticky fingers. These objects can be identified because when you move the cursor over them, it will change into a yellow target.
Oh, the locker.
The locker on Rex's right contains some items, all of which will be of use to you. Left-click on it to open it. The container object menu is exactly the same as the looting menu. Take the grenades and the stim pack from the locker by left-clicking on the Take All button to save time. Remember that you can put objects into containers as well as take them out. The inventory window will remain open, so close it when you're finished.
Take all, then, okay.
The final type of weapon we will cover is the thrown weapon. Drag one of the hand grenades from your inventory into your right hand. Your right hand should still be your selected hand, but if not, then left-click on it. Grenades do damage to all characters within a radius of effect. Right-click on one of the dummies at the far side of the room to throw the grenade at it.
Fine.
Now, open the next door and mosey in a military manner to Training Station 5 in the next room. Your characters have three sentry modes that can be set. These are selected using the buttons to the right of the right-hand slot. 1. Off. Only attack when specifically told to do so. 2. Defensive. Report back to the squad leader whenever an enemy is sighted and defend yourself if attacked. 3. Aggressive. Attack any hostile creatures if you have more than a 33% chance of hitting them. The attack threshold can be changed by right-clicking on the button. Now select the SMG and put Rex into attack mode by left-clicking on the aggressive button.
I'm assuming that's this one. Yes, okay. SMG, attack mode.
Your characters will have a choice of three stances. These are selected by using the buttons to the right of the sentry mode controls. One, standing. While this may be new to some of you tribals, standing upright has been around for years. It's also the default mode and the only mode where the character can run. Two, crouch. This is useful for getting under low obstacles. It also gives the character a higher chance to hit the enemy with guns because the weapon is held steadier. Crouching is also useful if there aren't any toilets around. Three, prone. This is useful for getting under very low obstacles. It also gives the character the highest chance to hit the enemy with guns. Some weapons, such as the knife, cannot be used when prone. But watch out, you are much more susceptible to melee attacks when prone. Now, crawl through the low doorway to training station 6.
Okay, let's go prone. Crawl through the low doorway. Can I stand now?
And then this lesson will introduce some of the skills that will be useful to you in the wastelands. Okay. The next door is locked, and you do not have the key to open it. However, you can pick the lock. Picking a lock is kind of like picking your nose. If you're successful, you're going to end up with some kind of reward. Walk up to the door and open the Skill Dex menu by right-clicking on the SKL button in the bottom right of the screen. In this menu, you will see a lockpick button. Left-click on the lockpick button to select it, and move the cursor over the door and left-click. Your character should attempt to pick the lock. Like all skills, there's always a chance that you will fail. If you do, then repeat the operation until the door is unlocked. Once the door is unlocked, open it and walk through to training station 7.
That comparison. Yeah.
Let's move on to stealth. The next door is closed because it is equipped with a motion detector that will keep it that way as long as it detects movement in this room. Your chance to sneak is improved when your character is crouched or prone, but remember, you cannot sneak while running. Also, certain types of bulky armor will reduce your chance to use stealth. Now, use the sneak skill by left-clicking on the sneak button in the Skill Dex menu and walk through the door to Training Station 8.
Okay, let's go prone. Skill, sneak through the door.
All right. The green bar on your character's tab indicates how healthy your character currently is. Your health can be restored by using the stim pack which you found earlier. This object can be used to restore health directly by double left-clicking on it in the inventory window, or drag it into one of your hands and select it so it can be used on yourself or fellow party members. Use it on yourself now by double left-clicking on it.
Impact. Okay.
All of the statistics which govern your character abilities can be viewed through the character window. This window is opened by left-clicking on the CHR button. Go ahead. Open this window now.
Wrong one.
The character window contains explanatory text for all of the statistics. This is accessed by left-clicking on the statistic in question.
So special has been around for a long time.
Skill points. These should be used to boost selected skills which you wish your character to specialize in. You will see that you currently have 20 spare skill points to spend. Use them to boost one or more skills. When you are finished, click the Done button.
All right. Good, great. Let's boost what we're already good at. How do I boost it? Oh, okay. There we go.
Finally, when you meet non-hostile characters, you can choose to talk to them. Some of these folks have valuable information regarding your mission.
NPCs.
However, some of these civilian pukes have less information than your average pile of steaming mutant feces. The Brotherhood scribe in the room happens to fall in category number one. Talk to him now by left-clicking on him.
Congratulations on getting this far, my son. You have completed this tutorial. Now, walk through the last door into the adjoining room. There you will be given access to a bath and a new mission.
Sweet. Ta-da! Okay. Do I want to do additional tutorials? There's no music, by the way. That works.
In this tutorial, we demonstrate how to set up an ambush and draw out the enemy using a decoy. This strategy is particularly effective against less intelligent enemies, such as the dog you will encounter here. As with most encounters, this mission can be completed in a number of different ways. Click on Start Mission to view a recorded movie showing how to execute this combat maneuver.
That is a very British slash Canadian way of spelling maneuver.
Start by selecting Strom and moving him into a position where he can carry out the ambush. He is armed with a submachine gun, which is an ideal short-range weapon for dispatching opponents. To get increased benefit, we will put him into a crouched stance and select the aggressive sentry mode. Next, select Dock and run him to a point which is far enough away from the dog so that he can avoid damage, but close enough to attract its attention. Now run away, Dock. Notice how effective the SMG is at close range. Now that you've seen an example of how
away,
a professional
Doc.
Soldier would approach the problem, let's see how well you do. Click on Done to continue.
Sure, let's do that. So I got Strom, run him over here. Crouch him. Doc, run here. Come on, doggy, run away. Oh shoot, I forgot to... Shit. Doc! That's why that run. Shit. Let's try that again.
In this tutorial, start by select. Now that you've seen an example,
I totally forgot to put Strom into attack mode. That was dumb. Okay. Aggressive. All right, now Doc. Dog not coming.
Well done. But remember,
that was not as fast as it showed in the video.
Be more resourceful and better armed.
Yay.
In this tutorial, you will learn about the benefits of the sneak skill and melee weapons. We will move the character with the highest sneak skill up to a point behind one of the raiders. Meanwhile, we will move the character with the SMG into a position suitable for taking out the raider's partner. Click on Start Mission to view a recorded movie showing how to execute this combat maneuver. Start by setting Ghost to Sneak Mode, Aggressive Mode, and Crouched. Walk him into the hut, hugging the back wall to maximize your chance of sneaking, and come up behind the leftmost raider. Meanwhile, set Strom to sneak mode. Crouch and walk him into the tent, trying to stay behind the low barriers.
So you can fire over those? Okay.
Reselect Ghost and attack the raider with the knife. Meanwhile, reselect Strom and attack the other raider with the SMG.
Ghost died.
Now that you've seen an example of how a professional soldier would approach the problem, let's...
All right. Ghost, aggressive, sneak. Here we go. And... Hold on. Sneak skill. There we go. Nope. Go back. Okay. Can't sneak and run. Okay. Okay, why I cannot sneak? There we go. Strong, aggressive, crouch, sneak. Right here. Ghost. Here. Storm here. There we go.
Congratulations.
Apparently
recruit.
Ghost died.
You're starting to understand some of the subtleties of close combat.
Alright, that was stealth sniper.
The final tutorial. You are faced with the problem of taking out an enemy who is entrenched in a well-defended position. You'll see how to use height to gain an advantage over the enemy. You'll also learn how to use area effect weapons in a relatively safe manner. Start by selecting both characters and put them into the prone position and sneak mode. Now, select Bullseye and move him to the top of the lookout tower to provide cover for Boomer. Whilst he's moving, select Boomer and get him to crawl around the other side of the bunker.
Whilst he's moving. Whilst.
Once he reaches the top of the stairs, switch Bullseye into aggressive mode to provide cover for Boomer. And use Boomer to throw grenades into the bunker. Whoa! See that mess, recruit? Well, guess who's gonna clean that up later? Now that you've seen an example of how a professional soldier...
Alright. Prone. Snake. Bullseye. Boomer. Okay. Okay, so moving doesn't use action points. Over here. Now, Bullseye, cover fire, Boomer, and there. There we go.
Well done, recruit. You have now completed your tactical training and may progress to real missions. If only the last class had been as successful.
Back we go. Okay. Try this again.
At ease, initiate.
Alright, we've been through that. Alright, all of you. I gotta go over here. Actually, nope, over here, hold on. One of you, Mick. Talk to the village elf.
Greetings to the Brotherhood of Steel. You are speaking with Charon, elder and tribal father to Brahmin Wood. You have arrived none too soon. Our village has fallen to raiders who rode out of the darkness. Some of my people escaped death or bondage by fleeing into the wasteland, but without tools and shelter. This must be the doing of the Brahmin god of fate. With the bandits we trade away our present, in the Brotherhood we trade away our future. Ah, very well, initiate. I fully agree to your terms. But I fear this decision will haunt me till I reach the eternal grazing field in the heavens. Our villages are being held prisoner in the camp. Save them, and you will have more people to aid your cause. Lose them, and you will be cutting Brahmin from your own herd.
Okay. Now we all move over here. So... let's look at mix skills. Mick is good at first aid. You're gonna see them over here. Farsight has a sniper. I think my dog is gay. What the hell? Farsight is also good at first aid, but behind that is sneak. Stitch is really good at first aid and doctor. So Mick, what else is he good at? Nothing in particular. Mick, do we have points? We do not. Okay, so... alright, so Stitch, let us see whether you can sneak yourself through here. Cannot sneak. Why can't you sneak? You're not a sneaky person, never mind. Alright, Farsight, let us see whether you can sneak yourself through here. Cannot sneak. Why can't you sneak? Fine, everybody move here. I don't care. Oh, and stand up. Okay, Mick, attack the dog. Farsight, attack the dog. Stitch, attack the dog. Okay. Attack that guy. Farsight, attack that guy. Mick, attack that guy. Everybody be aggressive. Okay. Farsight. Let's get you prone. Come over here. Mick, come over here. Stitch, come over here. Farsight, can you get over there? Mick and Stitch. Attack him. And Mick, attack him also. Does she need to move out from behind the... He's dead. Loot him. What do we got? What is this? Zip gun and a shiv. Yeah, let's just take it all for fun. What is this? A happy pie! What's it do? Amazingly still edible. I feel like Mick needs to eat this and heal. Alright, Mick. Come back over here. Stitch, come over here. Farsight. Over here, both of you run over here. Rah! Charge. All right, Raider is dead. All right, everybody stand up, and we're gonna go in here. I didn't need to loot the body. Hey, what's your name? Arsite. Oh, shit. Okay. Gonna kill you, then kill you again. Okay, Stitch is almost dead. Stitch, use your med kit. Okay. Okay. So let's loot the body. What do we got? Broken bottle. An Uzi. Let's take these. Uzi. What do we got? Strength 4, ammo 9mm, weighs 8 pounds. What kind of ammo is this? 9mm. Okay, what is this? Okay, so we're gonna give you this instead of the shotgun. Stitch, come over here, loot this guy. Pistol, Colt 45. Some 45 caliber rounds. Let's go ahead and take those. Alright, Stitch, come through here. I can't see what's under here, so that's not good. Alright, everybody, let's go through the door. It's locked. I didn't see anybody with the key. Okay, let's come over here and see if there's anybody here. There are. Wait, no, these are villagers. Let's talk to the shaman.
Greetings, hero. I have foreseen your coming since the first eve of troubles.
Sure.
I am Hawkeye. Spirit walker and soothsayer for my people. I guard the passage to the spirit world for the living. However, the waking world has turned against my people, and they have been scattered to the sands. You must speak with...
Okay, I spoke to the leader. Who has a key, damn it? Where is a key? Do you want to see my peace pipe? Oh, there's a chest. There's the key. And some ammo. What kind of ammo is this? 7.62. Do I have anything that fires a 7.62? Mick, you're getting the MP5, because that spear is just not helping. Alright, now we can go through this door. You guys too. Everybody, everybody. Everybody, come and attack back. Okay, he's dead. Here. Okay, he is dead. This shelf, though. What's in the shelf, Mick? Med thingy, Stimpax. Nope, that's not what I wanted, damn it. Take all now done. Alright, Mick, over here. Farsight, I need you to first aid. No, never mind. Doc, Stitch, I need you to first aid Farsight. Fire's item. Hold on. Is that on your cell? And I use this on Farsight. Farsight. What happened to the... Pick on Farsight. First aid, Farsight. Fire's item. So do I drop this into his hand? Okay, there we go. So now first aid on Farsight. Fire's item. Okay, never mind. Okay, so... Farsight, do you have any stim packs? Heal yourself real quick. Okay. Alright, now all of you. Isn't there a guy you can loot here? Okay, fine. Beretta 470 Silverhawk, so I'm guessing that's a lever action rifle. Okay, everybody, let's come in here. Okay, Mick, what do we got? Voodoo and healing powder. Guys, come over here. So they're sleeping. So who has the highest sleep? Okay, so I need you to prone. I need you to be defensive. I need you to sneak.
His name is John C.
You got me. That was startling. I thought it was in the game. Can I kill this dog without waking that one? Oh, shit. Everybody, aggressive. Dog. Shit, okay. Farsight, kill yourself again. Dog. What do we loot from the dog? Also, stand up, Farsight. Nothing in the dog. Let's loot this guy. I'm expecting I can sell these later. Yeah, I was absorbed. You got me. That looks like a gate. That looks like it would move. Well, yeah, it looks like it would move. Get everybody over here. Let's check out over this way. Okay, there are people inside here. I can see this now. Okay, so the bad guy's left. Mech needs to heal. Mech needs to heal again. Mech is apparently not great at healing himself. Okay, so let's loot this guy. If you ever turn on sound alerts when you start streaming again, expect a wave of revenge jump scares from me, Splatzap, and Crystal Eyes. Maybe. I do things like that to Eric, Artsmon, Artzimon. I didn't know this guy was dead. Why is he dead? This guy's dead. We got a hunting rifle and the ammo for that. Inside here. He did. Raid him, or search him. What is that? A spear gun. What are the stats on the spear gun? What does the bolt do? Penetration average. Eh, not gonna hurt to have it. Let's see what's in these shells. Shotgun ammo and mentats. What do mentats do? I know they increase your pillbox and mind-altering chems, increases memory-related functions, and speeds other mental processes. Highly addictive. I feel like behind all the razor wire is probably the leader, and I can't get anywhere else from here. So everybody come here. I see, okay, there's the door. So actually this is the wrong direction. Everybody over here. See the leader, I see him. Okay, so Farsight is going to crouch to here, and then these two are going to just rush the guy. Can't reach. How are we supposed to get through there? I thought you could fit through here. Okay. How are we supposed to? Over here, I guess. I see him. Do what you can. Just do what you can from here. He crouched. We can't see him. He did. And we didn't die. None of us died. So let's loot him. Oh, wait, we can get over this way. He has brass knuckles. Alright. We're through this door. It's unlocked now. Cool. Open it. Everybody through here. Okay, so there is more to do here. Awesome. I'm not digging this. I feel compelled / obligated to make it through the first mission, but this is taking forever. So we're gonna get through these guys and or around through this way. There's probably a guy up here. We're gonna have to come through here and then down to here or something. I never did even look over here. I didn't even realize. Wait a minute. No, I haven't been able to get into here. How do I get into here? I don't see. Don't see a doorway. There may have been a door here that I didn't see. I see a ladder there. But no, I don't see how to get into here. Well, I don't know. Okay, everybody over here. Let's see what's over here. Nothing. Okay. Here. Here. Dead. Okay, stand up and shoot this guy. He's dead. Alright, crouch again. Alright, Farsight needs to heal. There it is, Stitch. Farsight's dead. Awesome. Kill this motherfucker. Damn it. Oh, he was still on the med kit. Okay. What is this? A punch dagger. Nice. Farsight, I'm sorry you're dead. Mage loot the raider. Boys, let's go here. And maybe here. Now here. Shoot these guys. Okay. Nick, I need you to heal. Oh shit, there's a sniper. And Stitch is dead now. Now Stitch fell. Both of you. Let's see if we can get you up here. course not. Let me get you over here to where you can see this guy. Does anybody have a grenade? Mick, do you have grenades? What is this? It's booze. Stitch, do you have a grenade? There are days you wish you had a grenade. I don't know what to do here. I guess we're just gonna run away. Alright, boys, do your best to get here as fast as you can and not get shot too badly. Leader? Stitch, shoot him, Mick. Shoot him, reload. What? How do. What? Okay. Do I need to. Okay, so this is the Uzi. Shit. Alright, Mick is dead. Nope, that's not gonna do it. Okay, so we're out of that kind of ammo, so he needs a shotgun. Okay, there we go. Stitch and... Great. So I ran out of ammo. So yeah, there's still this whole building to clear. So yeah, I'm not making this. All right, Mick, come on over here. Let's see what we can do. Yeah, here's a bad guy right here. Gotta get up close and personal. And we're dead.
Your
All
last
right,
breath
we lose.
Is a pathetic attempt to clear your blood-filled lungs. If only you had another chance.
Yep. All right. I lose. I give up. That was better than Fallout 1. It was. But we're done. We done. We are finished. Okay, move things over. Okay. So Fallout Tactics was not god awful. There we go. But it was not good. Mostly because I'm a little bit of a graphics whore. So in between, I do want to try something else. I want to spin the wheel again. But in between, I have several beverages, and I still have peeps to try. Should I have a beverage, or should I have peeps? If there's anybody watching, throw your recommendation into the hot hat out. Nevermore says beverage. These are adult beverages, mostly. There are a lot of them. Nevermore says beverage. Anybody else? By the way, hi, Nevermore. Good to see you. I will just grab the four that are on the top shelf here. Paige got me a bunch last week or so, maybe 2 weeks ago, when she went to the liquor store. So we've got the Club Cocktails Mudslide, made with rum, non-dairy cream liqueur, natural flavors, and caramel color. Hi, Nevermore. I've been good. I regret not streaming on Sunday. I regret letting my inactivity throughout the rest of the day make me continue that trend of inactivity through the evening. I played video games all day. I had no physical activity, and that made me unmotivated to do anything. And so I regret not doing that. I regret missing that stream. I should have done something, had some kind of fun here on stream. So I've got Mudslide. So again, it's rum, non-dairy cream liqueur, natural flavors, and caramel color. So it's a Mudslide. So it's rum and cream liqueur. That's the thing. And it's 13%, and it's 200 milliliters. Then we've got Austin East Cider's Gold Imperial Cider, which sounds great with gold apples, I guess. 8.3% ABV. Okay. And then the original pickle shot, naturally flavored spicy pickle vodka. And then Duvel Belgian Strong Blonde. I have yet to encounter a strong blonde. Most of the strong beers I've seen have been pretty dark, or like IPAs can be really strong, like up in the 8 and 9%. This is a 8.5% strong blonde. So those are my, what is that, four options. So we've got the strong blonde, the East Cider's Gold Imperial Cider, the Mudslide, or the Pickle Shot. All of these are fairly strong. Nevermore says the Pickle Shot. I'm going to make this official. I'm going to do a poll. So we'll do which drink? Pickle Shot, Imperial Cider, Strong Blonde, or Mudslide. And that will be a 1 minute poll. You guys got 60 seconds to decide how I continue my Thirsty Thursday evening. In the meantime, let me bring back up the picker wheel to decide what we're going to do next game-wise. Oh, Nevermore, I have not been participating in your streams recently, and I apologize for that. I've been playing Dragon Age Inquisition, so I've been really absorbed into that. Errant Knight says, you think there's just two of you paying attention, so it's a tie unless you also pick Pickle Shot. Well, whichever you guys choose, even if it's two separate things, I will flip a coin if there are two separate things. But yeah, I've been playing Dragon Age, and then some of the relationships in Dragon Age reminded me of The Witcher 3 and made me want to play The Witcher 3, so I started that without having finished Dragon Age again. This time playing The Witcher, I'm going to romance Yennefer. Spoilers for a probably 8-year-old game. Yeah, 2015 was when it, yeah. Hey Google, flip a coin. Heads Pickle Shot, tails Mudslide. Chance, yes. We are Two-Face. Yeah. Tails will be the Mudslide. Let me put the rest back. Nevermore wants to play Witcher 3, but she don't want to hook up your Xbox or buy it for PC. Why don't you want to hook up your Xbox? What's wrong with that? Errant likes running nice orderly polls. That's fine. No, that's fine. It's fine. I had no preference there, my guy. No room. I imagine your space is probably fairly crowded. Just looking at your table when you're opening the card packs just gives me that you like, you have the vibe of a clutter in a positive way. Well, maybe not. I don't know. A cluttered person. Like, honestly, your second option was the Mudslide. Okay. So everybody's kind of happy here. But yeah, it's, I believe that you don't have room. Do you have a PlayStation? Or do you have another console hooked up? Because I'm playing on my PS5. And that's upstairs. Okay, let's get this open. Oh, I should have shaken that. Yep. I just flung a couple of drops on my desk. I should not have made that motion off camera. That was not good. You just have a small area for streaming, and the table for a trading card game is a small TV tray. But what about for gaming? not like necessarily on stream, unless you're wanting to play The Witcher on stream, which power to you. There are a lot of freaking side quests and map markers. I am barely like three steps into the main quest. I just met Yen and I just met Kira chasing after Ciri. And there are so many quest markers. The Novigrad area is giant. Gaming is the Xbox One hooked up on the TV behind you. Also two Nintendo Switches. Yeah, we have, I moved one of the Switches down here. We used to have two Switches connected to our TV upstairs. I have my GameCube that I can switch in and out. Our TV is fairly accessible. We don't have it on the wall, so I can get behind it and re-plug things pretty easily. So I've got my PS5. Technically my PS4 is still up there, but why play the PS4 when I have the PS5 and I can play PS4 games on it? Which is how I'm playing The Witcher and Dragon Age. The only PS5 game I have is Horizon Forbidden West. Eventually, I'll probably get God of War Ragnarok, but not like really soon. I'll have to find it on a sale, basically. I don't want to pay full price for it. And none of the used game places are going to have it for anything less than retail yet, anyway. The new Zelda game disappoints me. The trailers disappoint me. Mostly, the biggest disappointment is the goddamn rat rod that Link is driving. The car that looks hodgepodge together, just like the Banjo-Kazooie Nuts and Bolts, or is it Ratchet and Clank Nuts and Bolts? I think it's Banjo-Kazooie. The car. That just makes me so mad. It's like they gave up. They weren't trying. They're just like, okay, we're gonna throw a car building mechanic in here because we can't come up with any good ideas. And then also kind of pisses me off the boxes in Breath of the Wild that you manipulate with the Magnesis rune. Apparently there's a golem or a robot or whatever made of these boxes. Okay. I will rant some more when you get back from ads. Should have waited to try that until you got back from ads. That's pretty good though. It's pretty strong. It's pretty rum flavored. There's kind of some coconut flavor. It might be a coconut rum. The club cocktails produced since 1892. Sure. St. Genevieve, Missouri. Refrigerate after opening. What about refrigerating before opening? Are you like hard of hearing? Is that a thing? Why can you read lips? That's interesting. I like that. I don't know why I like that. You're not fluent, but you can sort of read lips. Like, I have fairly expressive lips, I think, so I probably make it a little bit easier than some people. Yup, which one? Yup, you're hard of hearing, or yup, you can just kind of read lips? I like to think I'm expressive, so it... Now you've got me conscious of how I'm moving my mouth. Okay, so the rant. So the rat rod... And the giant box golem robot thing that you see in the trailer, and then flying on the quadcopter drone platform thing. You just kind of read lips if you have an idea of what would be said. Okay, same, kind of. It feels like they weren't trying. It feels like they thought for a really long time and it's like, I give up. It's 6 years later, seven. Something like that. And we're just going to release what we've got. And yeah, I don't know. Like, I want to play it, but number one, I got disappointed by Horizon Forbidden West. It's a good game. It cannot be, and I should have like consciously told myself this before I bought it. It cannot be as good as Horizon Zero Dawn. Zero Dawn to me is the pinnacle of video games. It is my favorite video game I've ever played. It's got the greatest story, the greatest mechanics, the greatest main character. It's not perfect. Nothing is perfect, but it's the best. Hydrate time. It's the best I've played. And Forbidden West cannot have the same level of revealing the story as Zero Dawn. Oops. And 7 years from Breath of the Wild, and it was like a year and a half, 2 years later that they did that very first, very short teaser trailer. So we'll call that 5 years. And so they had all this time to work on it, and it feels like it's not as good as it should be for all of that time. Now, the beginning of this kind of disappointment was like The Incredibles 2. In the opening sequence before the movie, they have like, what's his name? Samuel Jackson and a couple of the other voice actors like, the wait was worth it. You waited 11 years. We get that, but it's worth it. Not sure. And maybe 80% worth it. Anyway. I guess a series of sequel disappointments has led me to not want to get Breath of the Wild 2 or Tears of the Kingdom as soon as it comes out. I'll probably get it eventually, maybe after it goes on sale at some point. Or maybe it'll just absolutely bomb and I can get it in a used game store for like $30 in a year. So this is pretty good. Paige is going to want me to save some of this for her. It's a pretty strong rum flavor, and then I can definitely see the cream liqueur in here. It took 5 years for Breath of the Wild to go on sale. Well, okay, that was the original Breath of the Wild. That is also, that's like the second best game I've ever played in my life. Okay, so I can imagine why that one would take a long time to go on sale. Tears of the Kingdom is like, you know, way down here, so it'll probably go on sale a lot sooner. Nintendo just doesn't put things on sale for a long time. I don't know enough about the history of Nintendo to say anything about that. But of the two, I can understand why the original Breath of the Wild didn't go on sale for a long time, and I can understand why Tears of the Kingdom might go on sale a lot sooner than Breath of the Wild. I can understand why that might happen. But I'm just not jazzed about it. And it takes place in the same, I guess, physical Hyrule. Nevermore loves Zelda games, but you also don't usually get them day one. Happens to be at Nintendo World in New York for the launch of the Switch, so we picked up a Switch for you and the Master's Edition of Breath of the Wild. Sold out everywhere, and you were sad you couldn't pre-order it. Yeah, well, I mean, like, I'm never going to pre-order anything anyway, because pre-ordering is stupid. Mostly because, like, if you buy the game before it's out, you have no idea what the actual game is going to be like. Nobody has played it except for a very small group of people. And of course, those people are going to say it's great or absolutely awful. And so you can't really trust either of those perceptions. And then also, if you buy the game before it's done, the incentive to finish it and polish it and make it good drops. Never going to pre-order anything now. Got burned too many times from pre-orders. I never did. I just heard about so many people getting burned. Like, Cyberpunk was one of the big ones, I think. And then a number of things. And yeah, just pre-ordering decreases the quality of the final product. Except until like a year or two or three later when all that stuff has been fixed. Because there's not the pressure of getting it out sooner. And there's, you know, enough backlash from all those people who did pre-order it not being satisfied with what they got from the pre-order. So yeah, pre-ordering is just dumb. Unless it's a simple, no story, MOBA, first-person shooter piece of crap. Anyway, lots of coconut flavor. Well, not lots, but some coconut flavor in this, like perceptible coconut flavor in this. Paige probably won't like this, but I need to save her just a little bit. Because she typically wants to try the things that I'm trying on stream. It's not bad. I'd drink another one if you handed it to me. Errant Knight has ordered pre-orders since you pre-ordered the collector's edition of Duke Nukem Forever. When was that? Let me try the collector's edition. A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Okay. Oh, so it was a release version. Okay. 2011. So you pre-ordered that. I just heard the, what's it called? Toaster oven. Beep. Paige just finished making her, or started making her, probably popcorn shrimp in the toaster oven. By the way, that May the 4th post on Twitter, Instagram, whichever that was great, Garrett Knight. You'd been waiting so long and you really liked Duke Nukem 3D, so you went for it. I feel like I've played maybe 5 or 10 minutes of a Duke Nukem game on an arcade machine. Maybe. Is it an arcade game? I think it was an arcade game. I may be wrong. If I did play it, it was a long time ago. Minimum 2 decades ago. Ew, Aaron's in here. Axie, Aaron told me to tell you, shut the fuck up. And I said, why? What did he do? And he said, telling him to shut up is its own why. Axie likes to bring up your Duke Nukem Forever purchase. Hey, Axie, do you pre-order games? Is that a thing for you? We were just talking about how pre-ordering games is dumb because it's, number one, less incentive for the developers to make it good because you've already paid for it. Whether it's good or not, they already have your money. And then also, it puts pressure on them because all these people pre-ordered it to get it out when they said they were going to do it. Yeah, Cyberpunk, that was the one. That's the main one that convinced me not to ever pre-order anything because all of these people got screwed over with Cyberpunk. I understand now it's a fine game. You can cancel pre-orders up until it ships. True, you can. You can cancel pre-orders up until it ships. However, if you know, you're early in the shipping queue and you get this game that you pre-ordered and it sucks, you're kind of screwed. They can go pound sand. What? Fallout Collectors pre-order. What? Fallout Collectors? What, is it a particular... Is it Fallout 4? Where the helmet was literally top... Wait, what? Was it still like off-gassing bad stuff? I sent moldy filter masks and a bag that was supposed to be a canvas bag, but it was flimsy. Was it which Fallout game was it? Was it 4 or was it 76? 76. Hold on. Hold on. Fallout 76 controversy. No, that's not it. Let's see. Pre-order controversy. Okay. While the helmet included with the pre-order hasn't been critiqued, the bag that was supposed to come with it was a cheap imitation of what was advertised. They were just trying to give the true Fallout experience. Yeah? Yeah? Well, no. Okay, it can't be the true Fallout experience because anything that would have survived 200 years in the wasteland would be tough. It would be screwed up, but it wouldn't be flimsy. Probably some radiation in the bag too. True. Let me look at this image here. Okay. Let's, there we go. So this was the bundle. So there's supposed to be a canvas bag and a helmet. And I guess it came in the box. And then there was like a miniature map thing. Huh. Open image in new tab. Let's just look at that. Oh, hey, here's a nice big image. At least we're not the people who've been pumping money into Star Citizen for a bajillion years. I don't even know what Star Citizen is. What is that? Somebody just went live. Johnny playing Overwatch. Your first person universe. How to play. Three ways to begin your adventure. Is this like a free game? It's a space sim game that has been in development since 2012. It looks like it's a thing. No, this is not it. Is this not the right one? Crowdfunding. What? Oh, the crowdfunding of the game? Did they not get... Hold on. Let's look at that. The core of this particular controversy is that the very idea that Cloud Imperium Games is using microtransactions to acquire more funding for a game that has already smashed crowdfunding records and ranks high among the most expensive games ever. You get it by contributing to the crowdfunding, you think, or maybe it's free, but all the ships cost real cash. Okay. So it's kind of everything. Yeah, it's made $550 million. Holy crap. So it's kind of everything that's wrong with modern games. Does it have a MOBA arena? Does it have a multiplayer online battle arena mode? It's an in-development multiplayer space trading and combat simulation game. Yeah, okay, so it's everything that's wrong with modern gaming. You don't get an entire finished game when you buy it. It's released in content updates and installments and everything. You have microtransactions within the game. You may or may not have a subscription to pay to continue playing the game. If you are waiting in between the content updates, it's months and months, and you play through that content in a day or two. Like maybe 8 to 12 hours of gameplay time. That's why the reason I hate Genshin Impact. It is a free game, but for me personally, the fact that it's not an entire game is the number one strike against it. Number two is all those microtransactions and in-game currency and gacha and all of that. And then the content updates are months and months apart. There are events in between those, but they're mostly just very grindy. Also, you have to like check in and do the daily stuff and grind and grind and grind and do every bit that there is to do every day, or else you're falling behind and you won't get your, five-star character of the week. And you know, more than likely, you're not going to get it anyway. But if you don't grind, you're almost guaranteed not to get it. And yeah. I told myself I wasn't going to rant about Genshin Impact anymore and just accept the fact that I am not a fan of continuous release games. But that's why I'm not a fan of continuous release games. It's kind of why I quit playing Disney Dreamlight Valley. Well, okay. I don't hate the continuous release part of Dreamlight Valley. It was a month or two after, I originally played it that they did the content update. And then it was another month or two after that that they did another content update. And so just that time of you're just supposed to be like farming and... But you're just supposed to be doing these daily monotonous... just time-wasting things in the game every day for 6 or 8 weeks until the next content update? No thanks. That's not why I play games. There have been about 4 updates for Disney, but how about since, like, February? I think there have only been 2. Yeah, 5,000 hours in Warframe, but it doesn't have the gambling mechanics, and you think the microtransactions are mostly done okay. Probably fair to say that most games get the continuous release thing wrong, and Warframe is an exception. Yeah, I think there's only been 2 releases. So the last content update that I played was Mirabelle from Encanto. I haven't done the Lion King one and whatever else has come also. Hydrate time. Ads in 1 minute, by the way. I don't know. So tell me, Axie and Errant Knight, how does Warframe get the continuous release right? Because I've only played two continuous release games. That's not true. I played on mobile for a while. I played Seven Deadly Sins. I can't remember what it was. It was Seven Deadly Sins Gacha game. And they were working through what has been released of the anime so far. In Warframe, you can get almost all the actual in-game content for free, and the microtransactions are either cosmetic or to skip the line or the skip the grind. Okay. So there's not really like a gacha thing? I really would appreciate that if there's not a gacha. I'm not going to play Warframe. I will say that. First-person shooters every once in a while, but multiplayer first-person shooters, either cooperative with randos or competitive, not my thing. I'm just not good enough to keep up with any of that, and I don't have the time to devote to it or the desire to devote to it. I don't have the 5,000 hours to devote to it. There are no loot boxes or gacha or whatever. So there aren't like special characters that you have to spend in-game currency on, or weapons or armor or whatever. You're telling me it's cosmetic or to skip the grind. That's 5,000 over 7 years. That's still a lot. Hey Google, what is 5,000 divided by 7? That is at least 2 hours a day. That's about 2 hours a day. Not quite 2 hours a day. All the Warframes and weapons can be earned through gameplay. Okay, that doesn't sound too bad. However, a game that does not have... So, I don't mind DLC. I don't mind adding additional content on top of the main story of the game. I love the Frozen Wilds and the... What's the other... No, it is just the Frozen Wilds. In Horizon Zero Dawn. It's great. I like in... What's it called? Dragon Age. I like the Jaws of Hakon. Well, actually, no. I don't care for the Jaws of Hakon, but that's just because I don't care for the Jaws of Hakon. But I like that... The Jaws of Hakon and The Descent and Trespasser are DLCs. You play through the entire game and you could not touch those and you'd still get a whole game experience. Rather than, you know, we've released the first quarter of this game or the first tenth of this game and expect you to pay for that or pay for a subscription or continually pay for gacha or loot boxes or, you know, the next best thing in this continuous release game while waiting 2 to 3 to more months for more story. And there's no defined endpoint of when this is going to end. I don't like that. There are theoretically 7 nations in Genshin Impact, 1 for each of the elements. And I think there are 4 available right now. Let's see, hold on. There's the wind one, the earth one, the electric one, and I think there's now the dendro one. I know it's animo, geo, electro, dendro. I think those are the ones that are available. And it's been out for like 2.5 years or something like that. So yeah, 2.5 years, almost 3 years. And that's not to say how people are saying that it copied Honkai Impact, which Johnny is now playing Honkai Star Rail, which I don't know how different that might be. Did I get the Sims DLC bundles? I did get those. What are you saving Errant Knight from? You can't say Warframe has a defined story endpoint either. The story has gone full psychedelic right now. Axie has also played 3,737 hours. 3,737, hey! I was looking at my money in The Witcher 3 today, and I had 43034 money. A lot better now that you think about it. Never mind. Damn, Steve, go touch grass. Go touch grass, people! You people with your long beards that never leave the house? And when you do, people stare at you and like, damn, his beard is long. 5,468 and a half hours. Wow. Now, I will say, this playthrough of Dragon Age, I've been taking it really slow and exploring every nook and cranny before I move on the story missions, and I'm at like 250 hours, but that's over a couple of weeks. But still, that's kind of a lot. That is three, four weeks, maybe. I can't remember when I started it. I did switch over to The Witcher 3 today because I kind of got bored with Dragon Age. Almost 5,500 hours. I have not played any game, any single game, for anywhere near that long. That, like, the most I've played any particular game is about a tenth of that. Errant Knight, if you think about that, I need that to be in your brain. I don't consider myself like a really casual gamer. I'll play a game until I'm done with it. At 8,766 hours, you should probably just delete your everything and move to a place with no internet. Is that like your total gameplay time of all games? What are we looking at? One calendar year worth of playtime. Oh, wow, you're approaching that, aren't you? I don't think since my adolescence that I've really played quite that much total. Oh, you mean specifically of just Warframe? Errant Knight, dude. You're about 2,000 off, but you think it'll hit eventually if the game stays up, which it may. I had a buddy invite me to play Destiny 2 with him, which my understanding is similar kind of ish to Warframe. Maybe? I bought Destiny 1 with one of the expansion packs a couple of years ago and never did really play through it much because I thought I misunderstood the online squad nature of the game. I thought you had to cooperate with whoever you were playing with to complete your objectives, and there are certain ones that you have to have everybody on the map working on the same thing at the same time, mostly shooting the same thing at the same time. But you can play through the story mode separate from that. You can complete the story objectives without necessarily having the squad working on those with you. But it's, I don't know, it's just not calling to me. The story isn't. It did make me laugh and then almost not cry, but sad a little bit when I realized that the voice of the heavy armor guy, like the Templar knight type guy, was the same as Silence, and I can't remember his name. Why can't I remember his name? What's his name? Lance Reddick! And then he died. Not quite two-thirds of the way. If your math is right, you'd have to play over 4 months straight, 24 hours a day, with no breaks to make up the difference. How much do you play in a day? So when was Warframe released? Not as much as you used to. Okay, so that's getting a little better. Oh, it's 10 years old? I don't know why I thought it was, like, maybe 5? Okay. So you're at, what is that? So it's 5,500 hours in 10 years. So that's 550 in a year. So that's depending on if you started playing at a launch. So that's like an hour and a half a day. Not even. That's not that bad, actually. But to stick with it that long, you've been playing 7 or 8 years. Okay, so maybe closer to 2 hours a day. That's not that long per day, but that's more the stick with it-ness. I have not played any game that long. Occasionally, I'll go back to some of my more retro, grew-up-with-me games. Like, I'll play Ocarina of Time or The Wind Waker again. Axie started before you, but you went off the deep end first. He started in beta, then took a long break, then it came up during a LAN party. LAN parties are still a thing? I guess they could be. Just because you don't have to be in the same room with your friends to play games doesn't mean you can't be. No, dude. That's what I'm saying. It's like, you can play remotely, but that doesn't mean you have to play remotely. So LAN parties are probably still pretty cool. Refuse to let it die. Like, yeah, I don't blame you. The first bachelor party I went to started with a LAN party. We played Halo 2. I was like 16. Yeah. And then we did Airsoft in the morning after being up until 2 in the morning playing Halo 2. We got up at like 6. You have moved to laptops mostly. Easier on the backs. So like actually on your lap. Hi, Lily. !Kitty to count the number of times the cats have shown up on stream. This is Lily. She's our Torby, which I only realized she was in like the last year and a half, maybe 2 years. Torby is a combination of tabby and tortoiseshell, or tortoiseshell and tabby, I guess is the order, meaning she has stripes, but she also has splotches. So tortoiseshell, you have gaming laptops to take to LAN parties rather than try to lug your desktop towers and monitors around. Okay. Yeah, no, I would not want to try to lug any of this around. My tower's not that heavy. There's not that much in it. But it's probably 20 pounds. Maybe? I feel like most of that weight is going to be the case itself. And then the next biggest weight thing is either the video card or the heatsink, for the fans, for the liquid cooling, for the CPU. And then the power supply. So when you're playing LAN party stuff, you're doing like lower quality graphics and or lower resource intensive games. I suppose Warframe would be one of the games where they would want to make it such that it's more accessible, because it is so multiplayer and LAN party and that kind of thing friendly. Although I guess maybe you're not necessarily playing Warframe at LAN parties. What do you play at LAN parties currently? I feel like Halo is still like the king of LAN party games. I really can't argue with that. What else did we play in LAN parties when I was in high school? Warframe is usually the Night Ender? Okay. I think we played StarCraft in LAN parties. What else? Oh man, it's been a while. I can't remember. So I've got Charlie all like lounged and stretched out over in the chair over here, and I wish I could show you guys, but I think that may be a big component of what's causing stream to crash. Haven't had one in a while, but the older games are common. Unreal Tournament 4, Rocket League. I don't like sports games, even Rocket Car Soccer. Like, that sounds awesome, but it's really not my thing. Left 4 Dead 2, okay, that would be a good one. most zombie games, COD, like some of the older COD games, I bet are probably good. Hydrate time again. So I was watching Mythbusters earlier, and they were doing the lead balloon one, where they successfully made a balloon out of lead foil and put helium in it, and it flew. You can make a balloon out of lead. It's really hard. It takes a lot of money and time and expertise, but you can do it. And Jamie built a... not a harness, but that's the closest word I can think of. A skate thing? I don't know. It went on a I-beam on the end of a forklift for Adam to, like, skate around over the very, very delicate foil and tape it together. And Jamie called it the world's largest and most expensive clear tape dispenser. And I thought of that after I bumped this tape dispenser with my water bottle over here. And yeah, that's a very apt description, because basically it's Adam dispensing tape on this really large, expensive thing that includes a forklift. Bye, Lily. Love you. I just randomly saw this. This is one of my most prized possessions. This is the, what's it called? The poster for I Fight Dragons' second album. I had them all autograph it when I went and saw them in Lawrence. They were originally supposed to do a show in Kansas City. And then something with the venue happened. I think the venue just shut down. Like, it went out of business. And so they're, like, scrambling last minute for a venue. I was like, hey, never mind, we're going to be in Lawrence. And I'm like, yes! That is, like, 45 minutes closer for me. It's great. You wish you had the money to just build the weird shit the Mythbusters do. Like, it's a great show. It ran for 7 or so years. I downloaded all of it, and I'm watching it, and it's fun. You're not a well-connected guy with engineering skills. Yeah, yeah. Well, making skills translate to engineering skills, and if you don't have engineering skills, it's just gonna break. It's just gonna blow up, which can be entertaining in itself, as long as you're not the kind of person that's just like, damn it! I expected this to work, and it didn't, and now I'm pissed off. Kinda like me. I'm that person. When my expectations aren't met, I get unhappy. You wouldn't like me when you don't meet my expectations. I've been having this, like, tightness right here in my sternum. And occasionally it'll pop, and it's not really a relief. I think I'm gonna ask my chiropractor about it next time I go in, like, a week, I guess. Next Friday, I think. Now Charlie has moved to the floor. Guys, it's hot. It's mid to late spring, and it makes me happy that it was like 90 something degrees on Saturday and Sunday. We went to the zoo. We got heat exhaustion. It was great. Paige got more heat exhaustion than I did. I was good after some water and about 30 minutes in the air conditioner. Paige had to go take a nap. Paige has to go take a nap most days, though. Paige is not in nearly as good a shape as I am. And I really doubt she will ever be, just because of who she is as a person. And that's not like a slight, that's not an attack. She's just different from me. And I like that my body is, you know, strong and capable. Strong, relatively. I could pick her up and carry her if need be. And, you know, I don't have to struggle to move things around the house for the most part, unless it's, you know, several hundred pounds of couch. I cannot move that on my own. Or 176 pounds of sand okay, let me tell you this story. So I probably already showed you some of this. I flipped over the boards, all 31 of them on my deck. I flipped over the boards. So this is the gray part is the boards that have not been flipped. The really clean, pristine white one here is a new board. I ended up replacing four because they were, like, really bad. Cracked all the way through or something like that. But the rest of them I flipped over, so you can see all the lines where they were laying on the joists underneath. And I had to flip them, like, this way. I couldn't just flip them like this because of the way things had bent and warped, and especially the way things were cut around the posts here. And what was my point here? I have lost my point. What was my point? I don't know. That I could do that without... Oh, okay. So we had bought a couple of weeks prior to this an offset umbrella, which I may or may not have a picture of. Why do I have a picture of this? I don't know. Okay, I don't have... Okay, here's the sandbag, though, right here. So we had this offset umbrella that had, like, a cross at the bottom that the pole was attached to in the middle, and then this sandbag with four chambers was sitting on top of that cross piece. And the manual... No, the manual said to fill it with 150 pounds of sand. The bag itself said to fill it with 176 pounds of sand. I don't know where 176 pounds came from. It's probably a conversion from kilograms. Hey Google, convert 176 pounds to kilograms. So it's about 80 kilograms. So it was probably a conversion from kilograms to pounds. Anyway, so I got it all in there and I got the umbrella set up, and then I decided, you know what, I'm gonna flip these damn boards. And I'm going to need to get this thing all the way off the deck eventually in order to stain and seal it once I'm done flipping the boards. And once the new boards, like this one, have finished drying out in roughly 30 days. So the whole thing's gonna have to come off the deck eventually. And then I decided, you know what? I'm going to attach the umbrella to the deck itself at this post. So it's got the cross bars that it had. On top of that sat the pole with, like, a plate at the bottom with four holes in the corners, a square plate. And those holes corresponded to holes in the cross piece. And you would just put a bolt through those and then put the sandbag on top of that, and it was supported. So I got rid of the cross piece and just basically got some U-bolt into that plate and drilled holes and screwed that to the deck boards, and then got, I'm going to say some more U-bolts, but not exactly. I had to finagle. I'll maybe take some pictures later. And put those around the pole of the umbrella, around the back of the actual post of the deck. So not only is it attached to the deck at the bottom, it's attached to the post such that the wind, the prevailing winds from the south, almost all of our wind comes from the south, not all of it, but most of the wind comes from the south. So when it blows from the south while the umbrella is open, which it's going to do because Kansas is, like, the windiest state. So Chicago is called the Windy City, but actually the windiest city in the country is El Dorado, Kansas. And it is pronounced El Dorado, not El Dorado. Because Kansas, because America, because Murica, just like Versailles, Kentucky, where Paige is from, instead of Versailles, it's Versailles. And there's Louisville. And, like, 10 miles away is Shelbyville, which is pronounced Ville, but Louisville is not pronounced Ville, it's pronounced Vol, because America. Anyway, so predominant winds from the south, prevailing winds from the south. It's attached and it's not gonna fall over. Anyway. I don't know where I was going with any of that. Let's not forget Notre Dame. Notre Dame, yeah, Notre Dame. Well, okay. I will say Dame is technically a part of English parlance, but it comes from Dame, from French for woman. But it is the English. Yeah. Okay. I keep telling myself that I'm not going to piss on Americans for the way they pronounce words that have been adopted from foreign languages. But then I go and do it anyway. Because, yes, Versailles is a French word. There's a town just north of us called Edinburgh. Is that anything like Edinburgh instead of... Oh, okay. So is the spelling Edinburgh, or is it spelled Edinburgh? Like, okay, I really can't... I oscillate between these. They kept the pronunciation and changed the spelling. Okay, so, right, that's what I'm trying to say, is because English is such a mishmash. English is so mishmashy. I oscillate between, like, okay, English is its own language, and it has its own pronunciation and spelling rules, and so pronouncing Versailles as Versailles, because it's phonetically spelled that way, kind of makes sense because it's English. At the same time, the town was named for Versailles, France, by probably French-descended settlers in Kentucky. So it's intended to be pronounced Versailles. However, Kentucky. I spelled my word. I am not Southern. I lived in the South for 12 years, and I very consciously decided I am not going to pick up an accent. I'm not going to pick up any of the idioms. I'm not going to pick up any of the slang. I am not going to fixin or yanta or holler or any of that. I am a good West Coast California boy with no accent. I spell. Okay, I can't have any more of the mudslide because then there won't be any left for Paige to have. However, I am still enjoying my whiskey. Ah, spelled. Every time I look at that, it's so funny. That night, were you here when I played the KFC dating sim? I love you, Colonel Sanders, a finger-licking good dating sim. It's free on Steam. Ariel, I believe, recommended it for me to try, and I'm so glad she did, because it is KFC propaganda. It is an advertisement. It is pushing 4, 5, 6 maybe of their products on you. The mac and cheese, the mashed potatoes, the chicken, the mac and cheese on the mashed potatoes, the biscuits. It's pushing their products on you in the guise of a dating sim. And the dating sim is not serious in the slightest. It was hilarious. I played it twice. Once just doing whatever. And then I played through with a tutorial to get the best ending, where you are both business partner and lover to the Colonel, who has like anime good looks. It's ridiculous. Hold on. Okay, here we go. This is what the Colonel looks like in the game. Like, it is messed up, but it's hilarious. And as long as you recognize it for what it is. Oh yeah, and the sporks. The sporks and the mashed potato monster and... And this is your character, this ridiculous anime girl. I don't know. And then this is your rival, who is just stupid at its tsundere and stupid. And it's so making fun of anime and dating sims and themselves. And the professor is a goddamned corgi. And there's a vending machine, right? Who tries to find love? Oh, and then there's this guy. And I don't even try to explain him. Hold on. Oh, no. It's his name is Clank from a faraway planet in another dimension. So he's a robot, some kind of machine. It's ridiculous. Is it on YouTube? Hold on. No, give me this. There we go. Studio. Studio was the word I needed to type. Hydrate time. Is that a VOD? Okay. There we go. So it is on YouTube. So it's a year and a half old now. But it's on my YouTube. I played through it once. And then what kind of otaku would I be if I didn't try for the best ending of a dating sim? So yeah. And then there's Fallout 76. Okay. What time is it? Oh shoot, I have bullshitted for like an hour, and now I don't really have time for another game. Do you guys want to shoot this shit some more? I am more than slightly drunk. It's great, it's good. I'm enjoying myself. I hope you guys are enjoying it. Up to me? Up to me, shoot. That's pressure, man. God damn it, I want to try these peeps. I'm going to try the peeps. That's what I'm going to do. Instead of playing a game, I'm going to try the peeps. So these are sparkly wild berry flavored peeps. And they're sparkly in the sense that they have little shiny pieces of, I'm assuming, sugar crystal crust that are purple. You're just being snarky while looking up things you can't afford. What are you looking up? I should look up more things I can't afford. Sparkly sugar dust. Okay, this is... I am struggling to open this. Lightsabers! Hey! Not my particular cup of tea, but hey, if you're having fun, what would I look up that I can't afford? Because no lightsabers can be multiple hundred dollars. You have three, but they're not full contact. Oh, so you want a full contact one. That's probably upwards of $1,000. Okay. So people hate on peeps so much, but they're literally just sugar-covered marshmallows. They're really not that bad. I even kind of like waiting for them to get a little bit hard, so give them a couple of months, and, you know, eating them that way. I think we've talked about this, Aaron Knight. You like peeps. They're official decorative Disney official models. You said official twice, my guy. Is that the ones you have? Yeah, probably. As far as the peeps. They smell nice. They smell like mixed berries. I'm trying to figure out if the flavor is throughout the marshmallow, and I think it is. Well, maybe not. No. Okay. Never mind. The flavor, the wild berry flavor, I think is only in the sparkly purple sugar dust flakes that are on the exterior. Because it wasn't until I like touched my tongue to the rest of it rather than just like the interior of the mallow part that I tasted the wild berry. So it's colored marshmallow with flavored sugar dust flake thingies on the outside. They're not bad. Not complaining about any of it. Not as good as the cookies and cream stuffed marshmallows that I got from Menards, which I found out they carry on a regular basis. This was not a limited time impulse buy by the register thing. They have them back in the grocery section of Menards. And if you've never been to a Menards, Like, it's almost worth visiting the Midwest just to go to a Menards, because it's like Home Depot and Lowe's. A little bit on, like, mild steroids. So there's everything you would expect in any home improvement store. There are tools, there's plumbing, there are fixtures, there's light, there's mechanical stuff, there's duct work, there are doors, windows, porches, fences, garden, stone, sand, everything you would expect at a home improvement store. There's also a work clothing section and an automotive section, and patio furniture, which is also, I guess, at most home improvement stores. And then there's also a dry and frozen grocery section. There's paint too. Okay, maybe it's not that much better slash different from a normal home improvement store. The more I think about that, the less, okay, maybe not worth visiting the Midwest just to see a Menards. But if you do happen to find yourself in the Midwest, going to Menards is a worthwhile thing to do, I think. Blew my grandparents' mind when they first saw it. My grandpa, who hoards tools and building material, like literal hoarder levels, he's organized about it, but my grandparents have been together for like 55 or something years. As far as I'm aware, in their entire relationship, they have never been able to fit a vehicle in their garage, even though they've had 2 and 3 bays in their garage for vehicles in my life, because of all of my grandpa's tools and building materials and shit that he hoards. It's organized, he can get around all of it and get to all of it, and he knows where everything is, but there's just so damn much of it, because you never know when something might be useful. And this was an expensive material when we got it for this job I was on, and this is left over, and like, it would be good to use for whatever, but it's not enough to use for whatever. To answer the question, you can get relatively inexpensive full contact lightsabers, but those aren't the ones you're looking at. You want the good ones. There we go. Kitty emotes. I'm not going to have any more of these right now. I'm going to let them sit. Gosh. I mildly inhaled some of the sugar dust. Now that they're open, I'm going to let them sit for a while and kind of dry out some to get to the consistency and texture that I kind of like. Nothing wrong with the regular marshmallow texture, but I like them a little bit chewier. Deals of the day that are under $100, but you're like, ooh, but this $600 one is so cool. Deals of the day from where? Let's open a incognito window. Ultra Sabers. Let's see what that deal of the day is from. Or deal of the day. Oh, yeah. Okay. That's not the worst. Okay, this Zia Sabers is more expensive, but there is a more expensive Ultra Sabers version. I guess proceed. Okay, so it's an ad, so I can't actually click through to that. Okay, let's go to Ultra Sabers. Oh, it's deal of the day category. Okay, drag that down here and let you guys see this. Normally $135, so this is literally 50% off. Standard issue Battle Saber is the workhorse of the Ultra Saber's arsenal. Designed to take punishment, perform faithfully, and be affordable enough for everyone. So this isn't extendable. These are not extendable sabers. They're fixed, but they're full contact. Now, these handles are very, very simply machined. There's not a lot to the decoration of these handles. They're, you know, a spin on a lathe with some automated toothy thingies on them. This one's a little more complicated. This one, and it probably costs more, yeah. Same here, yeah. This one has two buttons. One of our most combat-focused sabers in the Ultra Sabers arsenal, featuring a slanted shroud. Is that this part over here? Around the saber's emitter. Okay, and a rigid grip. The bellicose is perfect for fast, two-handed combat. You don't think it's the handle per se that the price is in. A lot of it is in the blade and electronics. Yeah, but a nicer handle, I'm sure, costs more. Yeah, like this one. This one is much more work to it versus this one that's, you know, simply turned on a blade. Sorry, this one. Oh, I like this one. The knurling. This one's fun. The Empress features a fearsome halo of eight claws around its 360-windowed emitter, an asymmetrical circuit board pattern that runs the length of the grip, and vented pommel that's made to boost sound. Available in four finishes. One, two, three, four. I like these first three way better than the gold one. This one could get into trouble with these. I don't even know what these are called. What are these called? I don't know. This is my favorite so far. A most impressive weapon made for single or dual wield use. I like this one with the cross guard here. I don't know why. I don't like the button sticking out like this. I prefer this kind of button, but I like this cross guard and these details here. Why am I looking at this? Because Errant Knight. This one's nice. It looks like it's got some kind of like stress relief pneumatic or hydraulic thing here, but it doesn't actually, I'm sure. Because why not? That's correct. The Archon version 3.1 brings another iconic and loved saber design to the Ultra Sabers lineup. Featuring a brass thin neck emitter and choice of pommels, the Archon 3.1 is full of some of the most coveted MHS compatible parts in the arsenal. So it's going to have a narrow blade if it's fitting down through here. The narrow emitter or thin neck emitter. So for this price, you're not getting both of these, right? Or are you? Because the other one was, you know, the first one was $67.50. This one kind of looks similar to one that Adam Savage built. I like blue. Ah, that's interesting. This is very much a single-handed weapon. Rise and claim the throne. The Dark Saber features one of the most unique designs in the Ultra Sabers lineup. An aggressive windowed emitter, a sleek yet sturdy guard, comfortable grip with layered details, and a horizontally vented pommel available in four distinct finishes. Ooh, this matte one is nice. But see, matte wouldn't really be realistic. This would be way more realistic. I don't know. Why am I even talking about this? Ooh, dual sabers. The first dual-bladed ultra saber contained in a seagull hilt. The Crimson Dominicide features a pair of MHS-compatible emitters wreathed in menacing claws and a comfortable ridged grip that spans across its midsection, available in four finishes. Orange, blue, gold. I don't know what other finish this is to show it. Because lightsabers are cool, that's true. Renegade, cross guard style emitter. Okay, so something I've wondered about, and Errant Knight, you may be able to answer this. So my understanding of lightsabers is that there's a crystal somewhere inside the pommel here, or inside the grip, the pommel is down here. And somewhere inside the grip is a crystal that emits some kind of energy that the grip directs out into a blade. So it's not a laser per se. How, lore-wise, how does it only extend a certain distance, and how is it physical? How is it, you know, a weapon that can be crossed with another lightsaber and not just pass through it like light? Because lightsaber, depending on the author, it's a plasma loop. Okay. I suppose that is talking about the length of the blade. Plasma is also not physical, or is not rigid? I don't know. Is this like Luke's original lightsaber? Is this very similar to that? Sturdy enough to duel with and beyond extravagant enough to display as a centerpiece in your collection. The Grayflex CE featuring comfortable grips, a covertic wheel, a switch activation box, and the iconic electrical pins of the storied lightsaber. This looks pretty close to the lightsaber. You're guessing some amount of force fields are involved. You don't know. Okay. I thought, since you were the lore whore, I don't know, man. I thought you might know. I guess you're not as knowledgeable as I thought you were. That is a totally overt attempt to bait you into trying to say something that you don't actually know about. So, Luke's saber was originally Anakin's saber. I read something recently. In fact, I may look this up. I read something to the effect. You're plenty knowledgeable, but lightsabers are just bullshit. They're awesome bullshit, but they are still bullshit. Okay. So I read something recently to the effect of the reason that people don't like Anakin is because Anakin was a young adult. He was an awkward adolescent who had really strong emotions, but no real frame of reference or experience to understand or manage them. And he was hormonal and he was in love and experiencing some of the greatest stresses ever for anybody. And he was impressionable and disillusioned and disappointed. And all those things are good traits to have in a fictional character, except throw them all together into one character and people hate them because it's too much like their own adolescent selves. And that's why people hate Anakin and Hayden Christensen's portrayal of Anakin in the prequels. And I don't think that's wrong. I don't disagree. What do you feel like, Aaron Knight? Seems like a reasonable argument. Yeah. Why would you say something so brave, yet so controversial, yet so brave? Yeah. Yeah, he was like, what, 21, 22? Looking back at 21, 22, I would, like, slap myself if I encountered my 21, 22-year-old son. Let alone having, like, you know, superpowers. and being in the middle of like world slash galaxy changing events and people and organizations. Yeah. I don't hate the prequels. Now, I was never a huge fan of the original trilogy to begin with. I pretty much just need it slapped every year from like 12 to 14. Valid. Or 12 to 24. Valid. Right around 24 or 25 was when I was beginning to figure myself out. And at that point, I didn't need slapping anymore. Aaron Knight doesn't hate the prequels, but how do I put this? I want to see this. I want to hear this. George Lucas is an amazing world builder, but needs help with storytelling. So is that a little bit like Tolkien, where the Lord of the Rings books were a byproduct of wanting to share the world that he had built? My understanding of Tolkien is he spent like either 15 or 25 years, one of those numbers in front of a five, just building Middle Earth in his head and in writing and then like the Silmarillion and whatever. And then to make it palatable and accessible to people, he wrote the Lord of the Rings books, is my understanding. He had the help with the storytelling in the original trilogy where he had his then wife and Steven Spielberg working on the scripts. Oh, I have no idea who directed any of the prequels, but I know it wasn't Spielberg. By the time the prequels rolled about, everyone, including him, is convinced of his genius, and no one tells him no. I've seen a meme in a couple of different formats. Something along the lines of, when you're hot, no one tells you the truth. For years, I thought I made great coffee or tea or whatever dish or drink or whatever you can think of, because people won't tell you, yeah, your tea sucks, even though you're hot. And that's probably a similar situation. There are some amazing ideas that just sort of trip. Yeah, I don't know. And you can see how well the world building holds up in the Dark Horse comics and in the Clone Wars cartoon. I've heard really, really good things about the Clone Wars show, especially about like Ahsoka and her and Anakin's relationship as Master and Padawan or whatever. And Obi-Wan's just like, Anakin, you're an idiot throughout the entire show. Like, what is the height of stupidity to you? Anakin, how tall are you? I know that's not actually in the show, but the memes are like top tier. yeah. Now, how much involvement does Lucas have in, like, the Mandalorian show? I haven't watched any of that either. Pretty great. Dark Horse Comics can get brutal. Yeah, brutal is not my thing. I tried reading some really brutal. No, I tried watching the Goblin Slayer show, and I think I made it maybe two or three episodes in, and nope, too much. Pretty great. Oh, I already read that. I'm just not really, my attention span. It's gone. Goblin Slayer is brutal in an entirely different way. Oh, is it? Okay. Is Errant Knight? God, is the Dark Horse brutal like emotionally? Because Goblin Slayer is brutal like physically, viscerally. Like the very first episode, the female mage's entire party gets killed and she gets stabbed with a poison dagger and then raped. Like Dark Horse, you just see people getting broken down psychologically by the war. Okay, gotcha. Yeah, still not my cup of tea. And yeah, no, do I still have Goblin Slayer on my Plex? I probably just need to go ahead and remove it because yeah, no, it's just not for me. Not really. Yeah, just thinking about that first episode. I'm not even sure I made it all the way through episode 2. I can't remember. Mmm. also reminds me of Invincible. I did not make it through two episodes of that either. That was really brutal and gruesome, and yeah, no. Not my, no. Not fun. Okay, so something I need to decide. In-laws will be here Thursday, this next Thursday. Mother-in-law is going to be working in Paige's office, slash maybe down here, depending. To answer the question, George Lucas is no longer involved in Star Wars at all. He sold it to Disney, and they've sidelined him entirely. A wise business choice, I suppose, because Disney is better at storytelling. You can't argue that. They're also way better at making money. Yeah. But hey, Lucas made his money and is continuing to make his money. So I gotta decide, once the in-laws are here, am I gonna stream while they're here? What is the game? I don't even know what the game is coming up next week. It is hidden. It is a mystery game. Is a mystery to be revealed next Thursday at 10 a.m. Central Time. Disney is hit or miss in the storytelling. The main trilogy was shit. The Mandalorian, Rogue One were great. Han Solo was okay, but badly timed. I am unfamiliar with the timing of the Solo movie. I do understand that, what's his name? Harrison Ford doesn't really care for acting. It was too soon after the main movie release. Is that like Rogue One? I don't know. He doesn't care for acting. He mostly does it because it pays the bills, is the main thing, is my understanding. That may be hearsay and rumor and absolutely false. That's the way I've read about it. Okay. Roberto is tired. Buttspot, you finally show up 3 hours into stream. No, one of the new trilogy, second one, you think. They released that in Christmas and then Han Solo in the spring, and people were just kind of Star Wars'd out. Okay, and then there were other movies because it was blockbuster season. Okay. So it was in between, and I don't know how true it is, but Disney has a reputation of doing things like that on purpose. Marketing poorly and timing poorly on purpose, so things will fail, be flops, and they don't have to put any more effort into it or can call it a flop and not try to pursue that type of animation or whatever anymore. My understanding is that was a big thing that occurred with Treasure Planet, which is a cinematic masterpiece to me. That is a weird thing to do to Star Wars, but like, they don't have to pay Harrison Ford to be in any more movies. Or CG young Harrison Ford. I don't know. But yeah, like Treasure Planet is the biggest. He wasn't in the Solo. Did they have to pay him to use his likeness? He had a younger actor? Did they not CG him? Am I just completely off base here? It was like a prequel. Okay. Ford was in one of the new movies. Like Finn, right? Which one was that? I don't remember. The one before, they didn't do CG. It was like about before Solo joined their band. So they just had someone who looked marginally like him, I guess. Or was just, it was young enough. Yeah, it was young enough that, okay, if it looked different than 30-something middle-aged, 30-something to middle-aged Harrison, then it was fine because it's that much. I don't know. I don't even know. Where was I? I have lost track of my train of thought. Hydrate time again. Didn't I just hydrate? I feel like I did just have some water, but not because the bot told me to. Okay. Roberto is done for the evening. My social battery has, well, my battery has run out. No idea what's coming up on Thursday. Won't know until next Thursday. In-laws will be here next Thursday, so Sunday may be the last time you'll see me for about a week and a half, maybe, depending on what we get up to. For now, the Fallout Tactics was much better play style and mechanics-wise than the original Fallout. I didn't so much care for... It's understandable, and I get why they did it, and that's part of what I like about Zero Dawn, but like the tribalism of the post-apocalyptic societies and the mysticism and the supernaturalism and the superstition, not a big fan. So the Fallout 4 was my first Fallout game, and I don't know when they began the, okay, these are people who are aware of a pre-apocalyptic, technologically advanced world, and some of that technology is still around, and we know how to operate as modern human beings. I don't know when they started that, but I prefer that to the world ended, and we're basically starting over from, like, Stone Age, except with modern weapons. I don't love that particular thought style. I'm not sure how to word that. But it was better. The actual gameplay and how it was played was better than the original Fallout 1. I did appreciate that. So Sunday we will spin the wheel again. We'll figure out what we're playing. What are our options again? Several. How many is this? 15, well, 14, because Fallout Tactics has been removed. So 14 options, one of which is just end the stream prematurely. It is a very small option. It's a 1 where everything else is a 4. You keep getting Spanish ads. Happens to me occasionally. But, Errant Knight, if you're getting irrelevant ads, that means you are successfully avoiding being tracked. And I consider that a win. I am proud of getting irrelevant ads. I get ads for parenting or children stuff. I get ads for testosterone products. I get ads for losing hair. I get ads for... I occasionally get Spanish ads. I get ads for... what is it? The Cheetos mac and cheese? I don't care. But the amount of ads you get for Cleveland, they at least know where you are. Like, okay, it's hard, unless you're using a VPN, it's hard not to get ads for where your IP is physically. However, ads for your lifestyle, if you're getting irrelevant ads for that, I consider that a win. It's good. Works for me. Like, you guys want to see Pie Hole here? So, looking at... There we go. Curry types. No, just go away. So, Pie Hole is a device that I actually got physically right here on the desk in front of me. This here. It's a Raspberry Pi that's running Raspberry Pi OS. Which Errant Knight is familiar with, a Pie Hole. This is like $80, and it takes maybe an hour to set up. The hardest part was getting my router, which is a Linksys router, to use the Pie Hole as its only DNS. You can't have a secondary DNS outside of the Pie Hole, because then you'll still get ads. When it can't get contact through the Pie Hole as the DNS, it'll go through the secondary DNS to the ad servers. So you have to be able to figure out on your particular router how to use the pie-hole as the only DNS. That was the roughest part for me. Looking at the query log, no, that's not actually helpful. Looking at my dashboard here, over the last, 24 hours? Yeah. 35,000 total queries. Literally half of those, a little bit more than half of those, were blocked via either ads or tracking. Yeah, okay, 54.1%. Either ads or tracking type of things were blocked. A good number of that is page on her phone. From 11:20 a.m. to 11:29 a.m. What was going on? What was I doing? What was I doing this morning? I can't remember. But, like, we've got a Roku TV upstairs. It has its own tracking of what we're doing on the TV. What we're watching, what apps we're using, that kind of thing. And it blocks that. And what is this red stuff? I guess it's all going to say pie hole. I don't know what all of this is. I really don't. But yeah, 54% of my queries were blocked over the last 24 hours. More than half of the traffic on my network was either ads or tracking. What is this? Tools. I may just need to remove this list. Okay. So yeah. Let's look at the log. We didn't crash all stream. So having the browser source for 3 hours worth of streaming, my uptime is, 3 hours and 9 minutes. We did not have a crash. We didn't have the encoder freeze. So it's not the browser source as far as I can tell. So next stream, I'm going to be adding back, you know what? And not this one, but the rest of these can just disappear. I don't really care to have all these game icons on the desktop. I can just access them separately. There we go. So next stream, I'll be adding back the kitty cam. You won't be able to trigger it with the command yet. We'll eventually get back there. But I'll be adding back the kitty cam to see whether that is what's causing the crashes of the encoder, to where everything freezes until I change scenes, unless I wait too long and then the whole thing crashes and whatnot. There was an update. I did update OBS. There was an update that said something along the lines of a message where if you're using the NVENC AVI-1 encoder, which I may or may not be using, that adds a message when it crashes. So if that happens, once I add the kitty cam back, maybe I'll get a message about it and I can actually see what's happening. But as far as I can tell, the browser sources of Stream Elements and Sound Alerts are not causing the crash, because we have not crashed in over 3 hours of streaming now. Not been a problem. So Sunday, we'll add back the kitty cam and try that. If that works, my best guess is that I was looking around in my OBS settings prior to stream, and I noticed that I had a, what was it? A 20 second, no, that wasn't it. Where was it? I don't know, I had a replay buffer of like 20 seconds or something, where OBS was continually recording streaming for the last 20 seconds. And I think that may have had something to do with it. Maybe. So if I add the kitty cam back and it doesn't crash then I will attribute it to the replay buffer and we will switch back to the full capability of my stream. And then if I have problems then, I'll just have to switch back to here and try to add things back one by one and figure out what the hell is going on. But otherwise, see you on Sunday. Everybody have a great night, great last couple of days of the week and weekend, and I will see you then. We will be spinning the wheel again to try one of those 15, 14 options, 13 options, or end stream. Have a great night. Be safe. Stay hydrated. Don't do anything you don't want to explain to the paramedics. I don't know why that is just a funny thing to me, but yeah. Do that. Don't do that. I don't know. Bye.